The following message by Pastor Dennis Clark and Dr. Jennifer Clark is brought to you by Full Stature Ministries and its supporters. For more information about Full Stature Ministries, please visit forgive123.com. That's forgive123.com.
Let's pray. I want to give you an opportunity today to do a little check on yourselves to see just how spiritually healthy you are. How many think you're spiritually healthy? Well, that's interesting. I've got a lot to work with. Four people. Oh, you're going to love this message. This is for you, literally. Literally, for you. Okay. Let's just start with that. I want to begin by saying this message is how believers can be fully functional, a fully functioning believer. Wouldn't you like to be a fully functioning believer? You know what that reminds me of? That reminds me of like if you have an 8-cylinder automobile, you want it to fire on all cylinders, right? You don't want it to fire on 6. You know what that sounds like when an automobile misses? Backfires, makes all kinds of noise because it's not firing properly. Well, I believe that there's nine cylinders the way God created us, and we're going to fire on all nine, or at least we're going to be challenged to fire on all nine. All right? So now let's pray. Father, in the name of the Lord Jesus, the Holy Spirit, we're going to have ears to hear what the Spirit says. And if there is a particular area that we're not firing properly, we're going to open up our heart and believe for God to do a major work, an overhaul, take us into the shop, pull the engine. I don't know why I'm in automotive talk this morning, but he's going to pull that engine out and rebuild it and put it back in, and it's going to operate better than ever before. Yeah, this is a 9-cylinder spirit that we've got. That's right. We're going to operate on all 9 cylinders. So, to fully function. Say that back to me. I want to fully function. Some of you, even when you said that by discernment, you're only firing on 6 or 7. All right. So, we're going to work on that this morning. Father, they're firing. At least they're alive. They've got gas in their tank. We just got to get them to where they get good mileage. All right. There's 4 great needs in the body before we get to the 9 cylinders. There's 4 great needs. And over the years, Jennifer and I both made the same observation. She got hers by revelation. I got mine by observation, revelation, I guess. But I saw the need, great needs in individuals' lives. And the first one, of course, is trust. Trust is foundational. And Jennifer later was praying, and she got the 4 predestined. You know, there's only 4 predestined in the New Testament, predestined. And all 4 of those predestined are basically the 4 principles that I kept seeing over and over again in people's lives. They were basically that there needed to be trust. And when trust was established, you knew love. You can't know the love of God if you never trust Him. Do you realize that? You can't. And then once you know you've got that love of God at some measure to where it's a reality, then you can move into functioning properly. And when you function properly, you reproduce according to kind. So I'm going to read to you where basically God opened it up when even as a young believer, in Genesis chapter 1, verses 26 through 28. Just in those 2 verses, I saw the purpose of man. And it's clearly stated here in the book of beginnings, right from verse 27. So God created man in His own image. In the image of God, He created him. Male and female, He created him. And then God blessed them and said to them, be fruitful, multiply, fill the earth, subdue it, and have dominion over the fish of the sea, over the birds of the air, and every living thing that moves upon it. In that short, brief description of the creation of mankind, God basically put all of the elements in there. And Jennifer's got a revelation. She says, God keeps telling me predestined. So she looked it up, and sure enough, trust, then love, then value, then purpose. My words, based on Genesis 1, were the same. They were relationship, character, function, and reproduce. And we put those side by side. We said, basically, these are the four basic needs to function properly in general. We all need to start from the place of, I called it trust, but what was, Jennifer called it trust, I called it relationship. Well, isn't that what the first predestined says? Listen to this, Romans 8:30. Moreover, whom he predestined, these he called. Well, he called you to what? To a relationship and to trust him. Jesse Penn Lewis says, you cannot even know the love of God unless you trust him to come in, right? So trust is foundational. And here's the word of the Lord, I feel, that's important while we're on this. No longer are we going to really, should we tolerate this? I'm having trouble trusting God. You ever hear Christians say that? Have you ever said that? I'm having difficult trusting God. Do you know what you're saying? By default, you're turning yourself over to the prince of the power of the air who will cause you to do his will. So at some point, you better learn that you can't just keep saying, I'm having a hard time trusting God. You better start at some point, because you're either trusting him or the prince of the power of the air is going to have control over you. There's no middle ground there. There's a law of the spirit of life in Christ Jesus, and there's a law of sin and death. So who's going to control you? You're going to serve somebody, right? You might as well learn and do away with that. Let's do that before we get any farther, because people have had hurt and pain in their lives, and they've had their trust wounded. But I'll tell you what, you can forgive people for their breaking the trust level in you. But I'll tell you what, God never broke it. So you need to start right there and say, people you might have had some trouble with, but you better get back to God and start trusting him to work it out. So Father, in the name of Jesus, no longer am I going to say I'm having a hard time trusting God. If I'm having a hard time trusting God, I am totally vulnerable to the prince of the power of the air to do it according to his will. I do not want to surrender myself to his will and be led by anything of that nature. So Romans 8:30, moreover, whom he predestined. You were predestined and called to trust him in a relationship. Jennifer's word was trust, mine was relationship. And I said, when you start there in a trusting relationship, then you can know the love of God, which is the next level. Jennifer called the next level, or the four basic needs. She said, from trust you go to love. I said, you go from relationship to character. And we're both right. It's the love character. Isn't that the nature of God? Love. God is love. So character development is love development. It's his nature. But I saw something in this next element, and this is today's message. I believe that we're in a crossroads here, cyclically, at least for Kingdom Life Church and perhaps in a larger body of Christ. I believe that what we're in a little bit of a crossroads is that functioning. Functioning, or Jennifer's word was value. Let me explain something about value. How many know what intrinsic value is? Intrinsic means you didn't do anything. It was given to you. You are gold in the sight of God. It had nothing to do with your performance. It was before you were born, he loved you. You didn't even do anything right or wrong yet, and he loved you. That intrinsic value is there. But you must grow. Even as Jesus set us an example, who learned obedience by the things that he suffered, that intrinsic value still needs character development. You still need to grow in the love of God. You still need to learn obedience by the things you suffer. So intrinsic value is beautiful. He loved you before you did anything, but now in reciprocity, to show him that you're his child and that you appreciate all the love and the value that he's placed on you, you should want to respond. We love because he first loved us. We have to get it from him before you can give it. You can't give something you don't have. So receive that intrinsic value, but move on and begin to get to the point where you say, I want to grow in the grace and in the knowledge of God. I want to begin to drink in the character, the nature of Jesus more and more. I want to grow in his nature. I want more of his love, more power, more of him in my life is the attitude. And then thirdly, your value is determined based on function. Now, here's what I see, and the reason I say we're at a crossroads, I see people starting from the place where even the intrinsic value is not clear. I know the Bible says God loves me, but. Have you ever heard anybody say that? Maybe you've said that. I know God loves me, but. Right there is telling me a more implicit trust is going to be demanded if you're ever going to make any progress. You're going to have to just die to that flesh and start taking God at his word and start building an intimate relationship with him. Because I'll tell you what happens. People will run from that understanding, that character development, and they will go to performance to try to win love. Does that make sense? If you don't know that you're loved, you try to earn it. And many people are trying to earn the love that's already been made available to them. They fail to receive it, and they fail to develop in character through obedience. That's how you honor him. If you trust him and you honor him by obedience. Every baby step of obedience builds spiritual authority. It builds the character and the nature of his love in you to where you become a partaker of that divine nature in an ever-increasing moments. So I just believe that if we're going to function fully, that we're going to have to learn that we have to move from that intrinsic value of God's love, receiving it, drinking it in, walking in such a relationship of obedience that you build character by reciprocity, by your obedience showing him that I'm reciprocating that love. I love because you first loved me. And it's even then, I can't give God something that I haven't received. And then thirdly, your performance. If you understand your value properly, your performance as a believer will function as Sabbath sons and Sabbath daughters. Do you know what I mean by that? It means, remember, God worked and then entered his rest. We're to enter that rest of faith, so that God works. For it is God who is at work in you, both to will and to perform. We should be performing out of the place of peace, not out of the place of drudgery or performance or trying to win approval or value based on what I do. Real achievement comes out of obedience to God and doing the will of the Father. It should be a delight and it should be a pleasure, not drudgery. So I see that the four great needs of relationship, character development, functioning properly, not just functioning, because you can function with all the wrong motives, couldn't you? You could try to win people's love, win God's sense of love and value based on your performance, when in reality, God says, I already gave it to you. I'd rather you performed out of my love, out of my peace, out of my direction, my initiation, my motivation, my character, my attitude. Wouldn't that be a lot better? And how would you know if you're doing it? The peace of God would guard your heart and your mind. You would walk in lordship. Peace indicates that Jesus is Lord and that you're walking in the light that you have. Now, when Jennifer looked up these predestined, trust, love, value, purpose, listen to Romans 8:30. Moreover, whom he predestined, he called. He called to a trust relationship. Romans 1:13, in him you trusted after you heard the word of truth. Isn't that what happened? After you heard the word of the gospel, you trusted in him. Now, Romans 8:29 says, for whom he foreknew, He also predestined to be conformed to the image of his son, that he might be the firstborn among many brethren. Well, what was the image of his son? God, Jesus was love, and he was here to reveal the Father. He was an expression. I don't do anything except what I see my Father do. I don't say anything. He was the perfect expression of the invisible God. Jesus was earth walk, depicted the Father and the love of the Father that he has for us. Now, he predestined us to be conformed to the image. Well, that's character. That's the love nature. That's the second element. Didn't he deliver us from the power of darkness and translated us into the kingdom of what? The Son of his love. So we're in a love kingdom. Love is the essence of the kingdom. Ephesians 3:19, in the Amplified especially, it says that you might really come to know practically through experience for yourselves the love of Christ, which far surpasses mere knowledge. We've got to move from mere knowledge to an experiential knowledge of the love of God. You need to feel loved. You need to know in your knower that you're loved. Not just, I know the Bible says, but. That's going to have to go. Because you need to be filled with all your being unto the fullness of God, that you might have the richest measure of the divine presence and become a body wholly flooded and filled with God. Now, function or value, I'm using both of Jennifer's words and our words because we came up with the same four ingredients for a healthy life. We call them the four great needs. And basically, function or value, having predestined us to the adoption. You know what adoption means? He didn't just adopt us like we adopt a baby. Adoption meant he predestined us to mature to the point where we could take over the family business. That's full stature. In other words, you were predestined to mature. You were not predestined to stay babies forever. And you're going to have to learn to graduate from child to young man to mothers and fathers in Christ. It's going to be pivotal. And I believe many are standing at the crossroads of making that decision is, am I going to move to the next level? Remember, the child has learned a beautiful truth, that God is their source. But their whole world revolves around God supplying my need. And does he? Yeah, God will supply my need according to his riches and glory. But the child stays there. There's got to be a point where I am so loved, I want to reciprocate. I'm going to be a partaker of the divine nature. The word of God is going to dwell in me strong, and I'm going to overcome the wicked one, and I'm going to be strong. I'm going to move from just seeing God as my source and he's there for me. I'm going to move to the place to where I'm his instrument. And people are attracted to instruments because they see victory. When they see victory in that life, that's when the person's basically saying that I am functioning in victory. People know I'm functioning in victory. They want ministry from me, or they approach me for prayer or what have you because of the victory. I'm an instrument. But the day comes when you've got to even die to that and move to a higher level. Move to the place to where you say, but the goal of the Father through Jesus was to bring many sons unto glory. I should be partaker of that same goal, to see that many sons and daughters come to glory. Take on a more parental view of the church and see what I can do to draw the gold out of the other sons and daughters, to bring them up from children to young men to young women, to teach them how to be Sabbath sons and Sabbath daughters, how to enter that rest and then work out from that rest. It's God who is at work to will and to do. From that place of rest, you work in obedience. And rather than just emphasizing, look what I can do, I'm an instrument for God, you begin to look and say, I want to pull the gold out of sons and daughters so that they move to another level, that they be increased. That's called equipping. Actually, all fivefold ministers are supposed to be doing that, equipping the saints to do the work of the ministry, teaching them to bring forth the gold that's in them. Now, it says, Ephesians 1:5, having predestined, there's that word predestined again, having predestined us to adoption as Sabbath sons, that's our entry, Sabbath sons, by Jesus Christ to himself according to the good pleasure of his will. And his will always has his pleasure in it. Get rid of a spirit of religion that makes you think that a walk in the spirit is drudgery. That's religion. A walk in the spirit is pleasure. You should delight to do his will. It should be the food that you know not of. My food is to do the will of him who sent me and to finish the course. His pleasure and his will are always synonymous. It's his pleasure. Now, the last one, Ephesians 1:11. In him also we've obtained an inheritance, being predestined according to the purpose of him who works all things according to the counsel of his will. He's got a purpose for us. He wants us to reproduce, was my word, reproduce according to kind. But remember, when you reproduce according to kind, you only reproduce according to your kind, right? To the extent that you yourself are, you cannot reproduce beyond that. You can only give what you have, and you can only receive what you're open to receive, all right? So I'm going to say that again. Those that are note takers, write this down. Here's the four levels, starting with the bottom level and working your way up. Trust is level number one. Level number two is love. And you can't know the love until you start trusting. The third level is value. And remember, we said there's three parts to that value, because I watch people try to take a shortcut. And they try to earn their value without the trust and the love by performing. It's called a performance trap. So here's the three little levels. Put a 1, 2, 3 under that third area of value, because this is where I believe believers are. And this is where we want to move to another level. Intrinsic value, 1. 2, character development. 3, then performance. Doesn't that make sense? You can't just live on intrinsic value. That's kind of like where the world's at right now. Entitlement. There's no concept of achievement. I'm born, society owes me a living because I'm special. They kind of perverted a truth, didn't they? That in that specialness, there's no accountability and no responsibility. You're just special. I'm saying God's got a higher realm of how special you are, but in that specialness, you should reciprocate with some achievement. And that achievement should be character development first, performance second. If the character development is in you, it will be developed by reason of use in baby steps of obedience. I like to say baby steps because I'll tell you what, some of the best things don't happen with one big radical transformation. They happen step by step, day by day, moment by moment. And God's looking for a relationship, not a project. God's basically saying that value is where you want to fully function and fully function the proper way. The fourth element is purpose. Do you have those four written down? Because I'm going to mess you up now. I'm going to write my four. Those are Jennifer's four. We're saying the same thing, but we're using different words. She used trust, love, value, and purpose as the four great needs, and you must start at a lower one before you go to a higher one. Could you imagine telling somebody to just achieve in life and they're not even born again? Would that be dead works? Yeah. You think Christians could do dead works? Yeah. They could try to achieve without building the intimacy. Did I not prophesy? Did I not cast out devils? They can even move in the gifts. Depart from me, for I know you not, because you skipped intimacy. You who practice lawlessness, you went your own way and did it your own timing. You did what you thought was right. You flew by the seat of your pants. You did what was right in your own eyes. Just like in the book of Judges, you know, the whole story in the book of Judges is, and men did what was right in their own eyes. People always have an opinion, but I'll tell you what, it should never trump God's opinion. God's opinion is what matters. Now, here's my four, based on Genesis 1, 26 to 28. Jennifer got hers in prayer. I got mine from the Bible. I don't know if mine's better. Is mine better? We'll take a vote later. Here's mine. The first one was that God predestined me for a relationship, where Jennifer called it trust, a trusting relationship. It's not a relationship if you don't trust them. The second area was God says, to be conformed to my image, I want character development. And if you want to grow as a Christian, you can't change this order just because it's inconvenient. You've got to build an intimate relationship. You cannot skip intimacy with God and be religious and Christian and run all over and do whatever you think is cool. You need a relationship of intimacy. Secondly, character development. Be changed. Change is good. Look in the mirror and say, I need to change. I need to be more like Jesus every day. I want to look in the mirror and go, who is that? You are so changed, Dennis, I don't even recognize you. I want people to stop me and go, is that you? I want my face to glow like Moses, right? Yeah. Every cell in his physical body. Actually, to the discerning believer, I've seen people with that glow on their face, and you have too, haven't you? It may not be like Moses to where they covered, but it's observable even to the naked eye, isn't it? That's the impact of the Holy Spirit on every cell in your physical body. And like Jennifer teaches, every cell in your physical body has gates and channels. It's like binding and loosing. You know, bind and loose means permit and forbid. Gates and channels on the outside of your cell permit or forbid. And we say, open ye gates, let the King of glory that's rising in me go to every cell in my physical body, and I welcome physical healing to those cells. Bask in that, huh? Open ye gates, let the King of glory come in. Let Jesus the healer rise with healing in his wings and welcome him into every cell in my physical body. Okay. Lastly, purpose. I called it reproduce. Did I give you all four of mine? No. Relationship, character. Oh, function. That's what the sermon's about. Function. Can't skip that one. I'm only firing on 9 cylinders. One's sputtering a little bit. Bad gas. I'm gonna have to change and get some high octane stuff in there. All right. So mine was, God called you to a relationship. Before you were formed in your mother's womb, he desired you to be conformed to his image and have character development. Thirdly, he wanted you to function. He said, have dominion. He wanted you to have, how do you have dominion? You have to be under dominion before you have dominion. You don't take authority, you have to be under authority, and then you express that authority. You have authority. We always use that term, take authority. That always bothered me. You don't really take authority. You have authority if you are properly subordinate and under authority. Although we're still going to use that word, take authority. So we're not going to change. We can't change the whole church. Just, all right? We all know what we mean by that. So function for me was to operate from the place of peace. When the peace of God rules, Jesus is Lord and he's ruling. Function, a Sabbath son or a Sabbath daughter should be able to practice a peace walk to where your peace changes the atmosphere as opposed to people evangelizing you with their bad attitudes. If you're in a room with 3 angry people and you get upset, they evangelized you. Greater is he that's in you than he that's in the world. You need to be challenged to function more the way God intended you to function. You change the atmosphere. You bring the peace in. You be like David calming Saul instead of you getting irritated with Saul and becoming just like him. He throws a spear, you throw a spear back. I don't think that's what David had in mind as an example. Do you? No. And God basically then said, from functioning as Sabbath sons and Sabbath daughters, reproduce. Reproduce what? According to kind. I want to reproduce people who know how to enter into the rest of God, stay there, and walk in a moment-by-moment relationship. Because the whole reason we named the ministry many years ago Full Stature was that our goal was to bring them to maturity and to challenge saints that are biblically literate, that know the word inside out and backwards, but to move up in your experience to another level. It's not about learning more word. You probably know more word than you're living right now, right? I know more word than I'm living. I want to get my living up to the level of that word, to where it's a higher expression. I believe that we're in a great transition. Everything that we're teaching, that they're calling cutting edge or new, a term cutting edge, is basically we're teaching in you. Do you know most of the church is in God is for you? Can you picture that? God is for you. But technically, that's still child. God is for you. Everything we're teaching is, no, God in you. Yes, he's in heaven, but God in you. But I'm telling you, before this awakening breaks forth into the body of Christ, there's going to be a third level, and it's going to be God through you. And you're going to see the greater works. You're going to see greater works than these which you do. But I'll tell you what, if we don't start moving a little quicker on getting him in you, instead of all of our manifestations are, for the most part, external. It's almost like whether it's gold dust or slain in the spirit or physical healings, all of that's wonderful and it will continue and it will accelerate. But that doesn't mean your character development has to stop cold. What we need to do is move to where our attitude is not just what can God do for me, which is child, but that basically God is in me and I'm about to walk in victory and glory to glory, from faith to faith. I'm going to know that God is in me. I'm going to be God indwelt minded. I'm going to know that I'm walking in a moment by moment relationship, and I'm going to walk in lordship, not just Jesus is my Savior, but Jesus is my Lord. And how do I know? Because the peace of God is going to rule on a moment by moment relationship. To the degree peace is not in your life, he is not Lord in your life. Something else is, an attitude, a circumstance. Something is in the way. But when peace rules, Jesus rules. So we got to move from Savior mentality to Lordship. We've got to move from he's for you. You see, as a Savior, he did that for you. Lord is your chance to respond to that blessing. You need to make him Lord, not just your Savior. He did that for you. Didn't cost you nothing to receive salvation, did it? It was a free gift. But lordship is your response to him to show that you really, really love him. And it's going to be a revelation of not just to you, but in you. Now, I'm ready, Jennifer's ready, and all we pray for is the through you. I'm believing for that. I haven't seen it yet. I'm not satisfied with my own Christian walk. I've got revelation on in you. We're teaching the whole body of Christ. All of our books and teachings are getting them in you. But I'm already looking ahead, because in the past, everything I ever pioneered, I got bored with the old stuff when the new came. I had four dance teams, four worship teams, flags, banners, kids standing on chairs prophesying to adults, intercession. Children that had to come to church early to intercede. I had that in the early 80s when it wasn't popular. But as soon as it became across the board, I don't even see myself doing it anymore. I want to do what I feel God is saying. Take those things that have been relegated for the future and bring them into the now. Even take scriptures that have been relegated for the future. Like, greater is he that is in me than he is in the world. You got to live like that. You don't just quote it. If you're not living like that, that's been relegated to the future. Someday, maybe, someday. No. Now. How about consider it pure joy when you fall into various trials that the testing of your faith produces? Are you excited about facing some obstacles in your life, knowing that on the other side, it's going to produce something in me? Instead of bellyaching, complaining, and crying, that's still the child. Oh God, why did you let that happen? That's a child's response. The young man's response is, well, I'm going to overcome this thing. I'm going to get over that. I'm going to, Right? We got to move up. Now, you ready for the test? That was the introduction. I got 20 minutes to give you the rest. You want the 9 cylinders? This is just to check yourself out, because in the days ahead, we're going to have to move more closely into this reality. The first thing is, that Jesus wants to enter into the songs and the praises in the corporate assembly. What is your corporate worship like? Do you enter in, or do you just sing, or do you detach? That's a cylinder that God said from the beginning. The hour is coming now is when true worshipers worship the Father in spirit and truth. If you're going to fully function, which is the name of this message, to fully function, you have to operate in spirit and truth. You can't just sing the words and say, "That's I believe those words are true." You're supposed to be singing in union and communion with Him. You should be united in a congregation to where you're saying Jesus Himself is singing praises through all of us. And I'm part of that voice. His voice is flowing through me, along with everyone else. He's praising in the midst of us. Are you in a corporate worship service like a boulder in a stream? You're just kind of in the way? Or are you following the flow? Are you tracking? Can you tell the nuance of the worship? Can you tell what the Spirit of God is doing? Can you follow flow of the river? Or are you just a rock in the river? Do you get caught up in it? Or do you just stand there and are like a barrier and it all goes all around you? My soul does magnify the Lord and my spirit rejoices. Oh, that was a beautiful statement by Mary. There is a river that makes glad, isn't there? Mm-hmm. Question, what is corporate worship like for you? Cylinder number one in this functioning vehicle of ours. What's worship like for you? Write it down, question yourself later. What is worship like for you? And by the way, this has nothing to do with a worship team. This has to do with what's coming from your heart. It's not whether you like the song or you don't like the song. It has nothing to do with that. It has to do with what's coming from you. All right. The second cylinder in this nine-cylinder spiritual functioning, your private devotions. If you fully function, you not only worship in spirit and truth, but inspiration leaps off the word. You get into a devotion, there's life in your prayer time. I don't know about you, but I don't even read a word for understanding. I read the word until I meet the author of that word. It's got to have life. It's got to have life to me. It's got to be a living word. It's got to be a person. Jesus and His word are one. I want to meet the Jesus in the word. I want the Holy Spirit reality, the author of that word, to commune with my spirit. I don't read for my head. I drink instead of think, and I feed instead of read. What's your private devotions like? Question number two. Do you just read a daily bread? Punch the clock? I read my Bible for 20 minutes. I put in my time. What's it like for you? Does it come alive? Is there a reality? Do you get excited? A fully awakened spirit, inspiration, and the presence of God is sensed in their devotions. Do you sense the presence of God during your prayer time? Cylinder number three. If you fully function, you recognize the nature of God. We could say you hear His voice, but you know what? I find people get confused with that. You recognize His nature. I just watched recently, Romans 8:16 says, the Spirit Himself bears witness or speaks with our spirit that we are children of God, right? I don't hear a voice that says, I'm a child of God. But if I were to say, behold, what manner of love the Father has bestowed upon me that I should be called a child of God. Right here, it speaks to me right here. It's an impression. It's not a voice. God speaks to me more by impression and by His nature. I saw a little thing on the YouTube where a shepherd was calling its sheep. And a half a dozen people came up to imitate it, and it didn't work. That you can say the same words, but those sheep knew the nature, they knew the nature that was on the voice. And it was remarkable. All these people tried their best to get those sheep. And I'm telling you what, the sheep, just like church sheep, they were down there with their head down there and they were eating. They wouldn't even lift up their head to those strangers. Not necessarily come. They wouldn't even listen. Is this scriptural or what? My sheep know my voice. They don't know what he's saying. They know the nature. They know. I know when I hear a prophetic word whether his nature's on it or not. Not whether it's scriptural or not, whether his nature's on it or not. I've heard some angry preachers in my day. And it wasn't the nature of Jesus on it, even though they were preaching scripture. It was anger was attached to it. So I started looking at it. And lo and behold, the shepherd came and said the same thing all those people were trying to imitate. And I mean those sheep. Not only did their heads all come up at the same time, but they ran toward the shepherd. And I'm going, I'm a city boy, so this was like shocking to me. It was, but then all of a sudden, scripture opened up, my sheep know my voice. Why do I always talk farm talk? I mean, for me, livestock in Chicago was pigeons and maybe an occasional squirrel. But anyway, my sheep know my voice because the nature's on it. How well do you hear from God is not just voices. How well do you know that his nature resonates in your spirit, that your spirit bears witness with his spirit that you're a child of God? We used to do that when we traveled. We would go to churches and people would struggle with their salvation. My goodness, they've been in church forever. That's what we would do. We'd have them put their hand down here and close their eyes. Just get an attitude of prayer. And then I would whisper in their ear, "Behold what manner of love the Father has bestowed upon me that I should be called a child of God." And I just ask, does that feel good or bad? Good. There's your assurance. That's the assurance of your salvation because Romans 8:16, your spirit bears witness with this. That means your spirit feels it. We're so afraid of that word feel. Your spirit feels it. It resonates. It's like a tuning fork. It recognizes the witness, the feeling. We're going to get back to where all of a sudden you're going to be a touchy-feely bunch of people. Because we're going to restore your spiritual sensitivity to where you know his nature. You'll know when his nature is on a word, and you'll know when his nature is not on a word. I've watched more confusion in the prophetic that when basically you get a prophetic word, but there's a wrong nature on it, and you're looking at the content of the prophetic word, getting frustrated, when in reality, quite frankly, if you knew it wasn't the nature, wasn't Jesus on it, you should just dismiss it. Right? Just like those sheep. Those sheep are smarter than Christian sheep. They wouldn't listen to another voice. They didn't sit there and say, "Well, that false shepherd said the right words. It was a good word." Don't you think we ought to get beyond that? If sheep are considered not too bright and they don't listen to another voice, how much more should we learn his voice? And when his voice is attached to a word. Yikes. That's my bottom line. Yikes. All right. So the question is, do you hear God's voice or do you rely on other people to hear for you? It's time to graduate, isn't it? Do you hear God's voice or do you rely on other people to hear for you? You might need to grow in your intimacy with God to where you get familiar to that resonance and to his divine nature. You need to know him by the Spirit. Did I not prophesy? Did I not cast out devils? Depart from me, for I knew you not, you who work lawlessness. That means you basically went your own way and did what you thought was right in your own eyes. But basically, the missing ingredient was spirit-to-spirit intimacy. You failed to touch me spirit-to-spirit. You went your own way with your good ideas. Now, so the question there is, do you hear from God's voice? Are you aware of his nature? Or do you need to hear from somebody else? The fourth cylinder. A fully functioning human spirit discerns the human spirit of others. You can track with them You meet them spirit to spirit. The Bible says we're to know one another no longer according to the flesh. The flesh goes by observation, body language, by their behavior. And then you guess at motive. That's sinful. You don't guess at people's motives. If you don't know, inquire. Because that's judging. It's the opposite of discernment. Discernment is basically to track with somebody. Have you ever had somebody talk to you and there was hurt in their words while they were talking to you? That meant your spirit was bearing witness to their pain. You could actually minister accordingly then, couldn't you? When you know the source, when you know the nature, when you meet spirit to spirit. Luke 9:46-47, Jesus perceiving their thoughts. There was a dispute that arose among them as to which would be the greatest. Interesting. Which of us is going to be the greatest? And Jesus perceiving the thoughts of their heart took a little child and set him by him. Okay? Basically saying, here's what's wrong. If I just went by discernment, if I'd have been standing there right there by Jesus, of course it wouldn't have worked then because I wouldn't have been saved yet. But if I would have been saved standing and people were reasoning who's going to be the greatest, I could feel the friction in the conversation. Even if I didn't know specifically without a word of knowledge exactly what the conversation was about, you would feel the friction. Except you become like a little child. What's unique about a child? Well, they're humble. They're intuitive. They go more by their gut than their head. So as we mature, it doesn't mean you go more by your head. As you mature, you get more intuitive. That should be the spiritual walk. There's a spirit in man, and the breath of the Almighty is within him. But to fully function, you rely not on intellect, but you want to meet others spirit to spirit. Here's how you can tell when someone's operating from their head. If they operate from their head and they cannot connect with you by flow, if they're not connecting by flow, so maybe you're talking, but they're not connecting here, they will start another conversation. Right while you're talking. They're not connected. They only know the intellect. They don't know how to connect from the spirit. One of the most telltale signs somebody is not connected, not tracking, is when they start a separate conversation while you're talking. That's the easiest way to tell. No empathy. They can't sense the feelings of others intuitively. The goal is to connect and stay connected. So answer this question. Do you meet other people by the spirit and track in conversations, or do you listen based on the intellect, look at body language, and you only meet other people with your mind? Do you meet other people with your mind, or do you meet them with the spirit? The mind is going to miss the nuance. The mind is going to miss the nature. The mind is going to miss the motive. The mind is going to miss the attitude. The mind is going to miss the character. Do you meet others by the spirit and track, or do you meet them strictly by the intellect? How's that cylinder working for you? Next. This one's for Christian marriage, but it needs to be spoken boldly, really. Only in a Christian marriage, holy matrimony, got to change the words to clarify, there is a glory where spirits are able to sense each other's presence. In sexual intimacy, in a Christian marriage, allows the person to be spirit to spirit, literally to bring satisfaction and oneness into the other person. A glory that can exist nowhere else. There is a glory in that union that can be experienced nowhere else. And there are Christian couples that have not experienced that glory. Because even amongst married people, the question is, do you crave ecstasy or intimacy? Big difference. Intimacy is the goal. God's goal is oneness. His word is His will. His will is always love. And the ultimate goal is oneness. If it doesn't produce oneness, you've got something that's a facsimile of the real thing. Outside of marriage, it's spiritual suicide. It brings confusion to your identity. I cannot listen to someone who's had sexual relationships outside of marriage when they talk about love or lust. They don't know the difference. They've been deceived. They can't tell the difference. There's confusion. When we traveled, we would run into people occasionally that wanted ministry on that, and it's not hard to get them straightened away if you know what to do and how it operates. But we used to, for lack of a better term, we just called it the stupids. We didn't know what else to call it. All of a sudden, someone who is biblically literate, scholarly, all of it, following God, all of a sudden they would start saying weird things. They would just come up with stuff out of the blue. I'm talking about a bona fide, solid Christian woman or man all of a sudden saying, maybe that married man over there is who God wants for me. And I would say, you never talked like that before. All of a sudden you're talking like that. You got the stupids. More and likely there's been sexual contact because God, the enemy throws confusion in, even to a well-grounded Christian, they throw confusion in and they don't know. All of a sudden it's like their eyes are blinded. And we would look, Jennifer and I would look, well, they got the stupid, so they must have had sexual contact somehow. Or, you don't understand. I gotta have a man for my son. Ended up saying, and wouldn't listen for guidance, ended up putting a fleece out and saying, the next person knocks on my door, I know that's the one God's sending me. And sure enough, the man knocked on the door and he was what, psychotic? Jennifer? He was psychotic. And she basically lost custody of that child because she took the first person that knocked on the door, gotta have a man for that child. The very thing she wanted was a father for that husband. The very thing she lost going the enemy's way was she lost custody of the child. When someone gets to stupids, they need truth, and they need someone to present them with that truth, right? And what's fashionable now is people saying, oh, I chose not to judge. What? You chose to let them go down the tubes. Is that what you're saying? You know, that kind of thing. So, every sin that a man does outside of his body, but he who commits sexual immorality sins against his own body. And there's a soul tie. And that soul tie is demonic. That's the one sin that you have to deal with from the place of repentance and deliverance. They need that broken. There's no such thing as sexual sin without demonic activity. I'm sorry. It just doesn't happen. And it gives confusion to the person's identity. When they get clean, clarity comes back. That's the beauty of it. Clean, clarity comes back. It says, whoever commits adultery with a woman lacks understanding. He who does so destroys his own soul. You just fracture your thought processes and your view of everything. And you'll try to justify it somehow. Question. Obviously, this is for married people. Single people, do not answer this question. Do you experience the glory in marital union? Or is that cylinder not firing? Think we could grow in the grace and in the knowledge of God? Next, to fully awake and have a fully awakened spirit, your conscience stops you before you sin. If you're firing on the proper cylinder, you have a conscience down here. If it goes, that means don't do it, right? If you override that conscience, eventually you won't even hear it. Like having your phone ring, put a pillow on it, and then put another pillow on it, eventually you won't hear it even when it's ringing. That's a seared conscience. But God wants a sensitive conscience. I still remember when Jennifer and I got married, the Lord told me, Jennifer had been abused enough in her life. She's been beat up enough. I says, God, if I ever hurt her feelings by accident or on purpose, make my conscience shout. The first time I hurt her feelings, I thought a donkey kicked me in the gut. And I went, well, I asked for that. That's a good thing to ask for. Because that conscience needs to be sensitive. What good is a conscience that doesn't listen? It's like coming to an intersection and the lights don't work. Everybody's confused. They take a start and then they stop and they see the other car taking a stop. That's why we have red light, green light, yellow light right in here. Obey the red light means don't do it. Green light means, okay, you got peace, go for it. Yellow light means, wait a minute. Doesn't mean hurry up, the red light's coming. No, no. Yellow light means caution. Wait on this one. Prepare yourself. Pray it through. But when you sin against the brethren and wound their weak conscience, you sin against Christ. We need to get sensitive to one another, don't we? My pet peeve in my first pastorate was people that said, I'm just speaking the truth in love. I'm going, wow. You may be speaking the truth, but I didn't feel no love coming from that statement. It's like Micah 6:8. Do justly, love mercy. But most of the time, Christians would rather love justice and do some occasional mercy, right? We kind of switch it around a little bit. But anyway, God will balance us out. The question, does your conscience warn you before you sin? How's that cylinder firing in you? If you're going to fully function, all of these cylinders need to function, unless you're single. You don't need the marital union one, all right? Does your conscience warn you beforehand? Or does it only, are you prone to guilt and shame? You know what that means? That's a remorse conscience that only registers after the fact. That means you need a little bit of work. A remorse conscience is, oh, I feel really bad. I shouldn't have said that. I shouldn't have done that. That means you're kind of a racehorse there, and you're making your decisions and your actions, and you're overriding your conscience, because the red light did warn, or the yellow light or the red light would have told you, yeah, shut up. Don't go there. Let it go. See, even resisting temptation. You know how to resist temptation so you don't have to forgive all day long? I learned this the hard way. I forgave all day long. And then I found out there's a better way. This is the one you go, you listen to that conscience, you go, let it go. Life goes well. It really does. Shut up. Don't say it. Don't say it. Don't say it. And you get better at it. Practice makes permanent. It's by reason of use. So do you have a sensitive conscience or a remorse conscience? Anybody? Don't raise your hand. But you know the difference now. Guilt and shame means you already blew it. We're looking for sensitive conscience to where you can see yourself going, let it go, let it go. You're going to learn to let go so well. You're going to find out this is the will. And the will of God is like a river. And when stuff comes, you go, no, let the river flow. Nope, I'm not going to stop the river. Let it go. And not only that, then if you have something to say after you let it go, what you say will have the love of God on it, because love precedes peace. Peace precedes your discernment. Okay, next cylinder. If you are fully awake, a fully functioning spirit enjoys physical health. That doesn't mean you don't ever get sick, but when you get sick, does yours always last longer than everybody else's? Or do you manage to overcome quickly? You get over stuff fast. Because basically, your spirit is created in such a way, a sound heart is life to the body. Envy is rottenness to the bones. Negative attitudes can make you sick. I actually believe enough harbored unforgiveness can cause you to be arthritic, really. That doesn't mean everybody that's got arthritis has unforgiveness. I'm just saying it can affect your body in a negative way. The spirit of man will sustain him in sickness. What will the spirit of man will sustain him in sickness? But who can bear a broken spirit? A merry heart does good like a medicine, but a broken spirit dries up the bones. Beloved, I pray that you may prosper in all things and be in health as your soul prospers. Well, how does your soul prosper? When you deal with stuff properly, you don't sit there and stew on toxic emotions and you release them through forgiveness and get your peace back. Your soul is prospering your physical body. Even the CDC says that, right, Jennifer? We've included that in all our modules. The CDC, Center for Disease and Control, 90% of all physical ailments are emotionally based. So how much better? Those could be unsaved people. If they have basically good emotions, would have better health. Unsaved people. How much more with the fruit of the Spirit? The reason God gave us emotions would to be conduits for the fruit of the Spirit. How much more with the love, the joy, and the peace of God flowing through your physical body are you radiating health and healing to your physical body? So, do you resist illness and throw it off quickly? Or do you imagine, or do you are sick regularly and seems to last longer than it should? You might want to do like Jennifer and I do and just soak in the divine healer rising up to my physical. We don't wait till we're sick. We just say divine health rising up in my physical body. Every cell, open ye gates, let the King of glory come in. What a way to start the day. It takes you 2 or 3 minutes to do that. But just to be mindful that the healer lives in you. You don't have to call out to heaven or have a healing ministry. He's in you. All right, the next one. If you've got a fully functioning spirit, you have an ability to wait, a value time. Listen to this one closely. Time means like, for a Christian, if you use your charge card today, there's going to be a bill at the end of the month. Duh. Right? There are people who have no concept of that. There's something lost in the element of time. They don't follow the cadence of the Spirit. They don't have things that happened in the past. Can you recall those things that happened in your past so that you go, I don't want to do that again in the present. And in the future, for sure, I'm not going to do that again. That's healthy. You learn from the things of old, even the things in Scripture for our training, for our reproof, for our correction. Learn from history. But learn from your own history. What works, what doesn't work. Don't do the same thing over and over again. If it didn't work before, why would it work now? There's a sense in timing that enables a person to properly relate to time. A person who is, this area of their spirit is wounded. If this area is wounded in their spirit, they can only think in terms of the present. which could be very self-indulgent, couldn't it? If you only think in the terms of now, you got to have it now. You don't even think in terms, but there's going to be a bill coming at the end of the month. No, I got to have it now. I'm sure God wants me to have it now. Right? No concept of time. It's confined in the present. Even in marriage counseling, a lot of times people will say, if it's a troubled marriage, they'll say, do you remember when you guys got along well? They do that purposely. Can you remember a time when you were happy? Yeah, before we got married. No, you go back. Can you remember a time when it worked? Because we're trying to bring that which works, bring it into your now, because you're so blindsided in the now, you don't have a view for the future, and you haven't learned anything from the past. You are trapped, confined. But that's a product of your spirit. As a matter of fact, when you're lost in God, there should be a transcendence of time, right? To where you didn't even realize how much time you spent in prayer. See, time is a product of your spirit. You need to get on. I remember the time God told me I was scheduling my day every 15 minutes. A little legalistic. I quit doing that a long time ago. But in those 15 minutes, God basically said, he rebuked me once and he just said, Dennis, because if the phone rang at 10:15 and somebody wanted to, they didn't know my schedule, but that was 10 to 10:15 was not the time for the phone to ring. How come they didn't know that? That was my time to do study after my prayer. God said, Dennis, we're not on Eastern time, you're not on Central time, you're not on Rocky Mountain time, and you're not on West Coast time. You're on my time. And I had to surrender all of my scheduling and make myself available. And I'll tell you what, it's healthy, because I don't believe in 9 to 5 for me. For me, life goes on. It's God's clock, not my clock. That's for people who don't like their job, 9 to 5, right? Because the ones that love what they do, they don't keep track. Think about it. You keep going, I can't wait till I get out of here, can't wait till I get out of here. Do you know what? If you want to get out of there, maybe you be the best Christian you can be on that stinky job, and you just might get promoted by God, not man. Joseph, here's a good example. Remember, Joseph was thrown by his own brothers in a pit. Then he went to prison, falsely accused. He remembered the dream, way back, that beautiful dream, and looked to the future and overcame by faith. Isn't that beautiful? Joseph was a man who could deal with what happened in the past, but remember what God promised. Learned how to process through the negative. He says to his brothers, you meant it for evil against me, but God meant it for good in order to bring about, even this very day, to save many people alive. Don't waste your sorrows. Some of those sorrows were divine positioning. If you would respond properly, God was orchestrating a beautiful tapestry for your life that has a beautiful fulfillment and a great finale. This is a mere rehearsal for heaven. Next question. If you were fully functioning in your spirit, there would be a flow of divine creativity. Creativity comes from the spirit. Creativity comes, you would have God ideas on the job. You would have God ideas at home. You would have creativity that would flow naturally. It's a product of your spirit. Jennifer noticed something as a school psychologist that in the lower grades, 98% of the children, or 95%, I'll get the number wrong, but the vast majority of children scored very high on creativity skills. By the time they graduate from high school, 2% high on creativity skills. It was drummed out of you, regimented out of you. God wants to restore that to you. And I believe that prophesied a lot of people in the beginning of this service. I believe that there's a whole lot of dormant stuff in you that needs to come out if you would let it. Let the Holy Spirit teach you. He's more than willing to show you some. Step out. Doesn't all have to, every time you step out, doesn't have to be dangerous. Doesn't have to be a leap off a cliff. All it needs to be is baby steps of obedience and try it. Do you have the ability to relate effectively to past, present, and future? Next question. This is on the creativity. Do you have creative ideas and solutions to solve problems? You know, if we get out of our head and truly consult God, God gives wisdom. Wisdom is better than genius. Right, Jennifer? We learned that. A lot of smart people are really, really lacking in wisdom, aren't they? High IQ, but making really, really dumb life choices for themselves and others if they're in high places. But creativity, the wisdom that comes from God, is first pure. You got to be clean in the heart. When it's pure, it's peaceable, full of mercy, good fruit. Wisdom is the principal thing, not knowledge. Wisdom. It's the ability to use that knowledge correctly. And it's a product of your human spirit. It's available to whosoever would ask for it. The problem is not enough people are asking for it. They're shooting by the seat of their pants and they're just figuring that they have enough insight to navigate. David inquired and required of God, and God gave him a different strategy most of the time. It wasn't the same old way, over and over again. So, do you have creative ideas and solutions from the problems? That's all nine. All right? Let's pray. Father, right now in the days ahead, we're going to take these nine areas, and we're going to see what areas need to be honed in our lives. And we're going to release... We're going to receive forgiveness for any laziness on any one of these areas. We're asking right now, God, that we're going to daily pray to welcome God to awaken our personal spirit. We're going to ask Him for a new awakening in these nine areas. Let Him quicken them so that we're firing on all nine cylinders. And we pray that God would seal this work right now by the power of the Holy Spirit. Seal what you began in here. Take those areas where you put your finger on and teach us to go more fully and completely into the realm of the Spirit. I want to fire on all nine. I want to fully function, don't you? We're all going to fully function. I want to apply myself to the process. I want to recognize that I want to create an environment that is full of love, acceptance, and forgiveness. I want to recognize that it's not too late, that God can restore the years the locust has eaten. It doesn't matter how long I've done it wrong. And it's a process. And I'm willing to take baby steps of obedience, one step at a time, left foot in front of the right foot in front of the left foot, and I'm going to walk step by step into a greater freedom in the days ahead, in a closer walk with Jesus. Amen. Amen. Amen.
You've been listening to Pastor Dennis Clark and Dr. Jennifer Clark of Full Stature Ministries at forgive123.com. Full Stature Ministries reserve all copyright protections under applicable law. Our copyright policy is available at our website, forgive123.com. For more information about Full Stature Ministries and additional life-transforming materials, please visit Forgive123.com.
Did you know that we have an online school available? Hi, I'm Pastor Jason Clark. We invite you to join our international community of almost 1,000 students currently enrolled in a school like no other. Team Embassy equips believers to live in the Spirit by giving them the how-to tools for wholeness, intimacy with God, and living the abundant life Jesus promised us. You will learn how to heal emotional pain quickly and completely. you'll discover amazing keys to tap into the fruit of the Spirit and practice the presence of God as a lifestyle. Exciting courses available include the 60-Day Challenge, Self-Deliverance, Healing Rejection, Codependency, Intimate Prayer, The Functions of the Human Spirit, and many, many more. It's formatted so that you could take it with you on all your mobile devices. Sign up today at training.teamembassy.com. Be transformed. Become all God created you to be. You will never be the same.